Hello, everyone. It's wonderful to be here with you. As Angel said, my name is Alexandria Corey, and I am the Capital and Innovation Director here at ReFed. Alongside me today, you're seeing Julian Barber on the screen as well. He acts as the Energy and Environmental Strategy Manager at the Wonderful Company, in whom we have had the pleasure of working with for many months now, trying to bring this challenge to life. So it's finally here. Now, before we dive into the presentation, I wanted to just share a few words about how thrilled we are about the launch of this $1 million POM Payday and what it really means to us. First, the amount of interest and inquiry this innovation challenge has received has been wonderful to see, no pun intended, from solution providers of all shapes and sizes who are all really excited about this possibility of partnering with such an impressive global food and ag producer that is the Wonderful Company, who, in case you are not already familiar with, is dedicated to harvesting health and happiness around the world through its iconic consumer brands. And in addition to its commitment to bringing some of the best pistachios and citrus and water and wine and flowers to market, they also, of course, are a producer of pomegranates. And as you'll hear today, the Wonderful Company also wants to remain environmentally conscious along the way as they're producing all of these products, which is where you guys all come in to potentially help them transform this biomass that is produced from juicing pomegranates in POM Wonderful facilities into a valuable environmentally friendly resource. And ourselves at ReFed, as this national nonprofit dedicated to accelerating data-driven solutions to food waste, and one that really envisions a sustainable, resilient, and inclusive food system that optimizes environmental inputs, minimizes climate impacts, and really makes the best use of the food that we grow, ReFed is really proud to be serving as a strategic advisor and managing partner for this challenge. So not only does it provide this incredible opportunity for food waste fighting solution providers like yourselves, but it's really also a critical part of the more than $1 billion that this wonderful company, the Wonderful Company, has invested in sustainability and fighting climate change. So it's a true win-win for everybody. So what can you expect from today's webinar? Well, shortly I'll pass it over to Julian. He'll provide everyone with an introduction to the $1 million POM Payday. He'll talk about the application process, the eligibility and evaluation criteria that will be used, and then we'll open things up for question and answer. Now, I expect this presentation portion to last maybe 25 minutes or so. So please do be thinking about your questions as we've intentionally left a significant amount of time to make sure that we're able to address any and all inquiries that are coming from interested applicants. So as we dive in, just remember that at any point, you can hit that chat button on the bottom of your screens and submit your questions. We'll be monitoring and aggregating those as we go along. So without further ado, I'll hand it off to our fantastic partner, Julian Barber, who really has been leading the charge for their wonderful innovation challenges, POM Payday. Julian?
Thank you, Alex, and thanks everybody for joining us today. As Alex mentioned, my name is Julian Barber, and I manage the Innovation Challenge at the Wonderful Company. As America's largest farmer of tree crops and the nation's second largest produce company, the Wonderful Company truly understands that sustainability is crucial to the well-being of our planet and also critical to the health and success of our natural products. The Wonderful Innovation Challenge was really conceived as a tool to help spur sustainable innovation across our company and address some of those tough sustainability challenges that we face. We recognize that there's a wealth of talent out there working on to solve many of the challenging issues that we're working on every day. And our hope is that the challenge creates a platform for us to engage deeper with you all as solution providers for the mutual benefit of us both. So the first iteration of the Wonderful Innovation Challenge features a unique problem we are facing at POM Wonderful. POM Wonderful is a subsidiary of the Wonderful Company and produces many familiar consumer products such as the category leading 100% pomegranate juice. But rather than have me kind of tell you all the background, I'd just like to play a quick video for you all to watch and hopefully provide a little bit of helpful context.
Top of the world, eh? I'm on top of the world, eh? Waiting on this for a while now. Paying my dues to the I've tried to cut these corners, try to take the easy way. I kept on falling short of something. I could have gave up then, but then again I couldn't have, 'cause I've traveled all this way for something. I take it in, but don't look down.
'Cause I'm on top of the world, hey.
So hopefully that gives you a quick sense of what it is POM Wonderful does. Just a quick reminder, if you do have further questions about the background of the company or the harvest process, just a reminder that you can submit those through the chat function and we'll answer those at the end of the Q&A. So as you saw in that video, POM produces three main products, the fresh pomegranates, the arils, and the juice. This challenge is specifically focusing on the byproducts from the juicing process. And through juicing, we produce roughly 50,000 tons of husks that we call pomace. And this pomace consists of the dewatered husk seeds and pith. And it has about an 80% moisture content and an energy density of around 2,700 kilocalories per kilogram. Historically, we've sold this pomace as cattle feed, but we believe that there are solutions out there that can produce greater value from the pomegranate husks. And that's really the inspiration behind this challenge, is finding new and innovative ways to create value from pomace. Specifically, we're looking to create value, two types of value, economic and environmental. To sustain any solution relating to pomace, the solution has to be economically viable for both POM Wonderful and your business. So by no means is this an exhaustive list at all, but we're hoping to see economic value created in ways such as new consumer products that might be healthy snacks, cosmetics, or something else, maybe new materials, energy production, gas, agricultural enhancements, maybe like fertilizers, commercial inputs, or maybe colorings and dyes. But the real point here is to see what you all have to come up with. So that's the exciting part of this challenge. Beyond economic viability, we're looking for solutions that drive positive environmental and social value. So reducing GHG emissions, potentially serving as packaging substitutes, helping improve soil health, maybe offsetting carbon fuels, or generally enhancing the circularity of POM Wonderful's operations. So what we're offering in exchange for your brilliant ideas is a share of up to $1 million. The funds you apply for through this challenge will be used to support a pilot to demonstrate the value creation potential of the solution you propose. We recognize that solutions in this space will vary greatly in terms of technology readiness. That's why we ask that you tell us where you are now, where you are, and how you could best utilize your requested funding to demonstrate value. Maybe you're an existing lab scale technology that needs funding to test pomace for the first time with your solution. Maybe you have a demonstrated technology already, but you're looking for funding to prove the value creation with pomegranate husks at scale. Or perhaps you're a fully established company and you're looking for funding to prove out the economics, establish a scaled offtake agreement. Wherever you are, please be clear in your application what you're looking for and how a partnership with the Wonderful Company and POM Wonderful would help demonstrate the value creation potential of your proposal, both in terms of economic and environmental value. Since this isn't a one-size-fits-all approach here, winners from the challenge will enter into a three-month exclusive negotiation period with the Wonderful Company to come to commercial terms for the pilot they propose before receiving their funding. The pilot terms that we negotiate in this exclusive negotiation period will be based on the proposed timeline and scope provided in your application, and will clearly outline the use of your funds for your specific milestones and deliverables. Once we reach the terms, Teams may be provided with potential follow-on resources from the Wonderful Company, depending on the scope of the proposal. Examples here, you know, could include technical resources to help plan and build the pilot at POM, maybe business resources to help refine the economic modeling, or maybe logistical resources to help transport pomace, et cetera. Since we don't really know who or what will win, we can't be sure what these follow-on resources will look like right now. We can be pretty sure, and you can rest assured that, you know, we're going to work in partnership and good faith to make sure that, you know, we can come create a successful commercial arrangement. So hopefully this gives you some context on what it is we're looking for. If you still have questions, again, I'd encourage you to submit them through the chat function, as I see many of you are, and we'll get to them at the end of the Q&A period. But Alex, I'll pass it back to you to walk through the application process.
Yeah, awesome. Thanks, Julian. So hopefully you guys are as excited as we are. Fantastic video, and I love seeing all the questions coming in. But let's dive in just for a second here into the nitty-gritty of what it really looks like to join the challenge, which I see a lot of questions coming in about. So in terms of the application process, we've designed this four-stage process that you're seeing in front of you. So we've got a letter of intent, a full application, interviews, and then a virtual pitch day. So having opened this POM Payday a few weeks ago, we're currently still in the LOI phase. We're accepting applications between now and December 7th. So to reiterate, the absolute drop dead date that you can be submitting your letter of intent is December 7th. Now that said, and this is also very important, I highly encourage anyone that's seriously interested in submitting an LOI to do so ASAP. And there's a few reasons for that. One, LOIs are being reviewed on a rolling basis. So even though the deadline is technically December 7th, as applications come in, we're reviewing them on a rolling basis. The other benefit to getting your application sooner rather than later is because that gives applicants that are advanced to the full application stage an opportunity to really engage further with the Wonderful Company, which again, seeing a lot of the questions that are being asked, it seems to me like there's a lot of interest in communicating with the Wonderful Company, really trying to tailor your solutions to the needs that they have. And so that's, you know, reason why I get in that LOI. For those that are those applications that are deemed appropriate, moving into this RFI or request for information phase, that really will help solution providers to better prepare for that full application. So as an example, several early LOI submissions have actually already been reviewed to date, and the most qualified have actually moved into this request for information process ahead of that full application phase. So they're currently working on their solution specific questions for the Wonderful Company. So they're talking through pomace composition specs, the applicability to the needs of the Wonderful Company, economic analysis, the potential for pilot logistics, et cetera. Unfortunately, for those applications that are submitted too close or maybe even on the actual deadline of December 7th, we can't really guarantee that you're going to have as robust of a request for information period, because we're really going to start that full application shortly thereafter. So it's really to your advantage to get in your LOI ASAP. Now, once that LOI process is complete and applicants have received their tailored information back from the Wonderful Company, they will submit their full applications. And that is really just a chance to present your much more tailored and informed solution for review from the Wonderful Company. From there, there'll be this 30-minute interview. And thereafter, semifinalists will be invited to the final step in the process, which is all about this virtual pitch day. Now let's talk about who's going to be a part of that final virtual pitch day and ultimately deciding on the winners of the POM Payday. Overall, each of the judges that you're seeing on the screen in front of you, they've been handpicked for their deep expertise, whether that's in agriculture or food waste and sustainability, operations or investing. So first we've got Linda and Stuart Resnick. They're the co-founders and owners of the Wonderful Company. Next, we have leaders from the Wonderful Company sustainability team. So that includes Steve Schwartz and Ilya Florentine. We've also got the general manager for the POM Wonderful brand himself, Derek Miller. We've got impact investor and philanthropist, Jesse Fink, who has a very deep knowledge of the food waste sector. And then lastly, we have representatives from both Caltech, which is world-renowned science and engineering institute, and UCLA Center for Human Nutrition. So as I'm sure you guys are already, you know, telling, this is a really incredible opportunity to create awareness and adoption of your solutions to such a fantastic group of industry leading minds. Now, before I pass it back to Julian to share a little bit more of the details on the specific eligibility and evaluation criteria that are being used for POM Payday, reminder, get those questions in the chat. You guys are already doing it. Awesome. We'll get to those in just a couple more minutes here, I promise. So with that, back to you, Julian.
Great. Thanks, Alex. So eligibility is pretty simple for this challenge. There's three key things. First, the members of your applying team must be over 18 years old. Second, the team must be able to contract with a US entity so we can physically engage in that ultimate commercial contract with you. And finally, you must be pilot ready. Ultimately, we're looking for solutions to put to work in the near term. So you must be able to demonstrate value creation using POMACE in one form or another. Assuming you meet these three eligibility criteria, your proposals will be judged across six evaluation criteria, inclusive of innovation, economics, scalability, team, impact, and pilot potential. I've seen a few questions in the comment box touching on this, so maybe hopefully some of this will answer some of those. First and foremost, we're looking for solutions that generate meaningful value for POM Wonderful in the near term. Therefore, with respect to economics, we're looking for value creation as it relates to POM, not just for your company's financials. To maintain it, to maintain a solution at scale in any sense, the economics need to work out for both us and yourself. So please be clear in your application how a partnership will work and how value would be created for both sides. Next, we need to be able to see a path to pilot. So husks are not the most common feedstock out there. So we want to be sure that your solution can meaningfully create value from them efficiently. This could look like a lab scale test, an on-site project at the POM site, or an offtake to test the POMACE at your facility. Again, we expect a range of technology readiness and development here, but the sooner you can demonstrate an effective pilot that validates the value creation potential for the solution, the better off you are. You might remember a giant pile of pomegranate husks in one of the first slides. The 50,000 tons of husks is a lot, so we value the potential of your solution to manage that at scale. A solution that can deal with the entire amount of pomace will be valued greater than a solution that can only manage a few tons. However, just because you are early stage and can't deal with 50,000 tons today, that's not a big problem. We want to see the potential, keyword potential, to reach scale just as much as we want to see at scale today. So the path to scalability is what we're looking for. Another key criteria, of course, is the team. So every company is only as successful as their team, and we'll be looking for expertise and experience in your field that demonstrates you have what it takes to see a pilot through and scale the solution to create that meaningful value from the pomace. Moreover, we'll also be looking to understand your stakeholder relationships and past successes so we can get a sense for the dedication and trajectory of your team. And finally, this is an innovation challenge. So we'll be looking for solutions that produce impact while doing so in new and exciting ways. The judging team is going to value solutions that create unique and innovative environmental and social value. So please include in your application how you think your solution drives impact, creates innovative value, and ties into the wonderful company and POM Wonderful's missions and values. So as many of you know, and Alex mentioned, we're already over a month into our LOI period. We've already received many of your LOI applications, so thanks to those of you who have already submitted. I want to reiterate Alex's point around the importance of applying early. Since applications in the letter of intent period are assessed on a rolling basis, the sooner you apply, the sooner you can get moved onto the full application. The benefits of moving into that full application sooner are first that you get more time to work on the application questions, which is obvious. And secondly, like Alex mentioned, you will have more time to fill in that request for information. Since most of you are developing unique solutions, we expect there's going to be some detailed questions you need answered before developing a well-rounded full application. And this is why we're offering that RFI period. So the sooner you have your LOI submitted and get advanced through to the full application, the more time we will both have to make sure the questions you need answered are answered before the full application deadline. So get those LOI applications in as soon as you can. Start thinking through what information you might need to help better refine your proposal in the second round. And I did note that there are a few questions circulating around, you know, asking questions. And so we are trying to keep the LOI as simple as possible. So hopefully you won't need a lot of background information at the, you know, in the first stage. And then that request for information will, you know, cover a lot of the things around composition and follow-on questions that you might have specific to your solution. So winners of the full application round will then advance through a virtual interview and a final pitch day in mid-March. And then finally, the challenge winners will be notified by April 1st and enter into that contract negotiation period from April to July. And so, I mean, that covers the timeline and some of the basics here. I think there's a lot of questions to get into. So why don't we jump into questions from the audience?
Perfect. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for submitting your questions. Julie, I think we'll just kick it off with a kind of hopefully quick and easy question for you. What excites you and the POM team most about this challenge right now?
I mean, it's what's exciting for us is to kind of, you know, democratize the, you know, solution development for some of these tough sustainability challenges. We work on some specific projects, but I think there's a lot of working on so many cool ideas that we don't have any insight into. And so we're hoping that this innovation challenge really opens our eyes to the possibilities of value creation in the food waste space and help improve some of the, you know, circular stories around POM and, you know, creating value from waste. So those are kind of the quick, exciting things, and, you know, really looking forward to seeing all the unique applications that come through this.
Definitely. So Julian, we're getting a ton of questions about kind of the frequency of the generation of the pumice. So could you tell us more about its seasonality and if it's generated daily, yearly, weekly, and just a little bit more context there?
Yeah, so the POM Wonderful operates in kind of a harvest period between somewhere around, you know, mid-September, October to December, New Year. And so the pomace is, you know, all the juice is created in that time. And so all the pomace is, you know, all the pomace and pomegranate husks are created during that time. So it's all created within a, you know, 3 to 4 month window in the near the end of the year.
Awesome. Thanks. We're also getting a bunch of questions about kind of the nutritional makeup. Just wondering if maybe you could provide just a little bit more granular detail about, you know, whether there's still residual juice, if there's still acid, you know, any additives, mm-hmm. things like that.
Yeah. So, I mentioned that it has the 80% moisture content and the energy density, which are kind of some of the, you know, super general high level stuff. We do have some past nutritional breakdowns of the pomace that we've used in past research projects that we can share their general, and obviously weren't created for a specific use case, but those can be, requested in that RFI period. As for like the juicing, there's still 80% moisture in there. So there's still a good amount of liquid left. The initial juicing process gets the majority of it out, but there's definitely some, you know, moisture left over. So they're far from dried, like a dried biomass.
Mm-hmm. Great. So maybe switching gears, because we're also getting quite a few questions about the application process, and maybe Alex, you can chime in here a bit, but maybe tell us a bit more about, you know, what exactly that letter of intent is versus the full application, and also will TWC be open to reviewing more than one idea from a single applicant?
Yeah, sure. So the first point of that, the difference between the LOI and the full application, like I mentioned before, the letter of intent is meant to just be a initial screen. So hopefully you don't, you know, I'm sure there's lots of questions out there, but hopefully you don't need a lot of specific answers to fill in that letter of intent. We've intentionally made it short and simple to try to get, you know, it's basically that first screen to allow you to tell us what your, solution is, how you intend to create value, you know, why you find it innovative, some of your past successes. And so that's just the initial screen. And then in the full application, we ask to get a little more detailed on basically everything from what it is to how it's innovative to how the economics will work to your pilot proposal, things like that. So that's why we include the RFI at the end of the full application. Part of the reason for doing that is to also, you know, limit the time constraint on our side around, you know, answering questions, you know, providing answers for everybody who's applying, you know. So the we're hoping to provide specific answers to people who advance through to the full application after submitting a hopefully short and succinct letter of intent.
Perfect.
And I will just say, adding to that, I've gotten a few questions from interested applicants. You know, again, nothing is perfect. We did try, as Julian mentioned, to design the LOI in a way where we're really just trying to get to know who you are, what you've done, your traction to date. But there are some questions around, like Julian said, what are your ideas for how this could drive value? And I understand that you might not have all of the answers right now and know the ins and outs of how the business works, but I would not use that as an excuse to kind of not submit your application. I think be open in your application about the ideas that you have. And if you've got a few things that are making some assumptions, call that out, right? I think there's an acknowledgement that there's more information that would be helpful. And so that's why we built in this RFI. But definitely just use that LOI as a way to kind of get your foot in the door, help us get to know you a bit, and, you know, start thinking about what are some of those questions and possible routes that you could go down to support the pomace challenge that they have. So don't let that be a reason not to submit if you think you have potential.
Thanks, Alex. Julian, could you tell us a bit about how the pomace is currently stored? And for applicants, you know, there's lots of people would like to sample it. So maybe tell us, you know, more about how that's a potential.
Sure. So we don't store it like that scale, right? So we offtake it, we sell it as dairy feed or cattle feed. But we have stored some of it from last year. We've frozen it and kept it. We are also right in the middle of harvest right now. So have the opportunity to store fresh pomace. So, you know, we intend that, we fully expect that some people will have requests to get some quantity of pomace. And so we've kept some from last year and have some fresh this year that we can send to people.
And generally, Julian, the way that we're thinking about doing that right now is for those that kind of pass the LOI stage and see a use case for receiving some samples. That's something that through the RFI process, people can actually note that they want to receive some, and we can include some details there, frozen versus fresh, you know, what quantity, et cetera. So that's something that comes at that request for information phase.
Yeah, right.
Great. And then I don't think we got to touch on this too much during the presentation, but could you tell us a bit more about IP and who owns it when it comes to this potential partnership?
Yeah, absolutely. So we tried to make it pretty clear in the rules that there is no confidential relationship between the wonderful company and applicants. Winners, we intend to, you know, enter into a non-disclosure agreement in the exclusive negotiation period so that we can get into the weeds. But anything that you're submitting in your LOI or full application, we'd encourage you to not disclose any like IP, anything related to IP that you feel uncomfortable disclosing. Some of the reasoning for this is that, you know, we may be working on things already currently because we have active work in this space, or we may be developing things in the future, or we might be receiving information from parties already that is similar to your request. And so we can't really enter into a non-disclosure agreement or any sort of confidentiality agreement with you without knowing what you're already working on. So it's kind of a chicken and the egg thing. And so we've decided just to, you know, be consistent with everyone and not have any confidential relationship made until winners are selected.
Yeah, thank you. And Julian, you also mentioned like the economic value creation. Can you expand on that and maybe very specifically tell us about kind of what applicants should be considering when presenting the prospective ROIs for TWC?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. Like I said, to be sustainable at scale, this needs to be economically viable for both the POM Wonderful team and for your business. And so we are looking to understand how that economic relationship works. And, you know, I'm hoping a lot of these ideas are going to be new that I've never heard of before. And so understanding the market and, you know, the the economics behind, if you're creating a product, for example, out of the pomace, you know, what that product sells for, what, you know, the margin is, and how the, you know, what the payment to POM is, what the payment to, you know, what the economics for the whole business are. I mean, it kind of is solution dependent, but we are looking to understand any scalable solution we work with, which is ideally, even if you're early stage, ultimately we would like to get to scale with you at some point. We are considering what our return on investment is for the POM Wonderful, your company relationship, right? So if it's an offtake agreement, what is the dollar per ton that you're paying the POM Wonderful company for the offtake? If it's more of a partnership with, you know, developing a facility on site, what those economics look like. If you're creating biogas through an anaerobic digester, what, you know, the credit, you know, what revenue streams are coming out of that, be them credits or revenue from the sale of the gas or whatever. So really looking to understand what the economic relationship is to the Wonderful company, POM Wonderful side, so we can make decisions around which projects have the financial stability to make it through and be long-lasting solutions for us.
That's super helpful.
One thing I just want to interject there, Julian, that you mentioned, I have gotten some questions around this, so just wondering if you want to provide any clarity around what a potential pilot could look like. So as people are thinking about the application of their solution, I have gotten inquiries around, well, is it possible that down the road, if this is viable, us to build something on site for the Wonderful company, or does everything have to be off site, you know, at our facilities? Can you speak to maybe what the range of possibility is there? Obviously not knowing what all the solutions are that might be submitted.
Yeah, for sure. That's a great question. And it is the range of possibilities, which is maybe an annoyingly vague answer. But you know, we are open to solutions, and we're open to what works best. And so I would almost flip it and encourage you to convince us why that is the best approach. And so if the best approach is to develop a facility on site, tell us why. If it is to have an offtake agreement, tell us why. If it's a transactional process, tell us why. If it's a partnership, tell us why. And you know, ideally that is backed, you know, the why there is, you know, an economic why or an environmental why, or, you know, there's ideally some reasoning behind what you're proposing, and it should tie to the evaluation criteria in some way. Maybe it ties better with our mission. Maybe it ties, it's more innovative, it's better economics, it's a better, you know, pilot potential, it's easier to scale. So I would just flip it around. We're not really, you know, we have space, some space to incorporate projects. I think as we get through to the negotiation period, a lot of those logistics will get worked out. But I think within the full application, the letter of intent for sure, and the full application and the interviews and the pitch, you know, just pitch to us what you think is best and convince us why, you know, you're proposing what you are, and we're basically open to anything that works.
Thank you. Julian, a quick logistical question for applicants is your facilities only in California?
Yes. So the POM Wonderful facility is in Delray, California. The Wonderful company broadly has, operations across the world, but the pomace is produced in Delray, California.
Perfect. Thank you. Let me just see with some other questions that are coming in. One thing, Julian, that people are wondering about is if you would be open to co-branding any product that came out of a potential pilot.
I guess that would be case by case, and would probably depend on what it was. The Wonderful company has very strong alignment around our brand and our brand values. And so it would depend greatly on what the product was, right? If it was a bag of chips or something, right? We focus on like healthy natural products that are grown and are very like minimal processing. It would have to be products that align into that value prop. But I wouldn't rule it out, but I guess it would be very dependent. And again, going back to the, tell us why you think that would work, you know, make the case for it. If you thought co-branding was a potential option, why do you think that? Do you think that, you know, we could bolster the economics? Is it you could create some sort of you know, better, you could tell some better story. Like, you know, I think again, open to basically anything, but interested to hear the whys behind it all.
Yeah. And another thing where people are wondering about is this $1 million, you know, is this for only one solution? Would it go towards, you know, multiple potential solutions? You know, how would the funding be allocated? Could you tell us a bit more about that?
Yeah, another great question. So the $1 million is up to $1 million. So if you think that you need all $1 million of it to prove out your solution, then I'd encourage you to submit for $1 million. If you think you only need, you know, 200,000 to, you know, determine, you know, to run a test with the pomegranate husks and prove out that, you know, maybe you've been running a process with orange peels for the last decade and you just need to, you know, $200,000 to, you know, make some tweaks on your pilot, you know, your facility or your product, and, you know, run some tests with pomace and prove out the, you know, the whatever comes out of it that works, then maybe you submit for a lower amount. But we are going to be looking for, you know, if there's a really great idea and that great idea needs $1 million, then, you know, that could be easily selected. But I don't think it doesn't mean that you should ask for $1 million, right? Ask for what you need, because we also would like to see, it would be beneficial to see multiple winners come out of this. And so, I guess it would be up to you guys. Again, asking for the whys. If there's a great reason as to why you need $1 million, and include it in your pitch and your proposal, and it'll be judged based on that. And if you need, you know, 50,000 or 10,000 or 350,000 or 600,000, submit that. And it'll all be, you know, just be really clear on the why about why you're kind of pitching the amount that you are, because that is very important in the decision-making process and helps us validate, you know, how far along you guys are and kind of how confident we are in the use of funds to actually meaningfully move the product through to a point where we'd be able to fully use it as a scalable solution at POM.
Thank you. You mentioned, Julian, that the Wonderful Company has specifically done the cattle feed as a solution. Could you tell us, you know, any insights or takeaways that came from that could inform the applicants just about what you learned?
I don't really know. I mean, so the cattle feed was a simple offtake agreement, right? A local dairy farmer was, you know, needed cattle feed and was willing to pay a price, and, you know, they just came and picked it up, paid it, and away it went. It was a pretty simple arrangement. And, you know, from this challenge, we could envision something that looks very similar to that. Maybe, you know, an established company wants to, you know, create some new consumer product with pomegranate husks, and they just want to pick it up and pay for it. That's a very simple, elegant solution. In that case, we'd really like to understand the economics and, you know, the market for that product and the sustainability of, you know, how will that product grow over time? So we have an understanding of how consistent that offtake agreement will be. But this might, you know, the result of this challenge might also look something similar, more like very different from that, right? That won't be an offtake agreement at all. It'll more be like it could be an on-site project, right? My mind goes directly to like a anaerobic digester, right? If, you know, if it's built on site and, you know, it's a partnership in building the anaerobic digester, and we're, you know, feeding in the pomace and producing gas and something, you know, there's some product that comes out of that. I don't know if there's any direct lessons learned from the current operations. It's pretty simple, straightforward. I think those, you know, an offtake agreement is a totally fine. It might actually be ideal in some senses because it's simple and easy to execute on. But that doesn't mean that that's the only thing we're looking for. If you have another idea or another arrangement in mind, we're very interested to hear what that is and why you think that arrangement works.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And Julian, just to quickly clarify on the eligibility piece, there are some people on the call who would be international applicants. So are they eligible for this competition?
Yes, international applicants are eligible as long as they can contract with a U.S. company. So at the end of the day, we are going to have a service contract. Winners will enter into a service contract for the amount that they requested, and we just need to be able to pay, you know, pay them that amount. So as long as you're an international entity that can do business with a U.S. entity, then you're good to go.
Great. Awesome. And also, could you tell us if there's any additional support beyond, you know, the financial support that people could receive that's on offer depending on the solution?
Yeah, I kind of touched on that in the deck a little bit. It's hard to really put a finger on it without knowing the solution. And I can, you know, this is why we have an RFI period, because a lot of these are so specific to individual solutions that it's tough to answer in generalities. But, you know, we have a team of a legal team, a strategy team, a business team, a capital projects team. We have, you know, the wonderful company has extensive resources, and we, you know, once the winner is selected and we have a service agreement in place, we, you know, have every intent to make that that work. And so, you know, from, you know, man hours in helping set up a pilot to logistics and shipping pomace and, you know, logistical support and helping plan out how a pilot might work and how it might scale. Those are some of the things that come to mind right away. But yeah, I mean, I guess it would, you know, I think in the RFI, if you have some specific questions about, like, you know, in, you know, understanding how support is given, or if there are additional support, you know, pieces of support that you specifically need, please outline those, because those will be super helpful to for us to understand and kind of engage with you on from an early stage. But I mean, to the other point, the point of the funding is to provide most of the support that you need, right? So the funding should, you know, it can be used for anything to help support the pilot and develop it into something that is, you know, demonstrates the value that we talked about. So, you know, that should be the key driver of support for this. And then whatever, you know, pieces of additional support that we can provide as the wonderful company, be it like connections to, you know, local government offices, or, you know, leveraging the network, our internal network, for to help, you know, advance the solution. Those are all things that are easily available. It's just, you know, it depends on the solution.
Great. Wonderful. Well, maybe just a couple more questions before we wrap up here. Some people have solutions that, you know, involve some more value-added processing opportunities. Would POM company be interested in having that in-house, or have a third party completely handle it and keep it super clean in that way?
So I think I missed the first part of the question, just glitched.
Oh, they were just wondering if the processing should be handled in-house with POM on site, or if you would prefer to have a third party handle it.
I mean, good question again, and I'm sorry for continually reiterating this specific solution answer, which may be not helpful, but you know, I think we're open to either. If it makes economic sense to process at POM for some reason, if there's an easy processing step that, you know, we're very well capable of handling and can help kind of pre-process or fully process it before shipping it out, then I think that's something we can discuss and talk about. And I think you should outline that in your application and talk about when we, you know, there's in the full application and LOI when they're actually, it's mostly the full application that has a question around, you know, the logistics around the pilot. Those are things, those are perfect things to include in there around how you envision this to work and why you envision it to work this way. And then, you know, as we advance through the virtual interviews and the pitch and the RFI, we will help you refine what works. And if there's a stumbling block for your specific solution that just is not possible, we'll let you know so that you can adapt your application and find something that does work.
And just going back to the point I made earlier and what I think a lot of questions kind of pointed to around samples of the pomace. So what I imagine a lot of you on the line, at least manufacturers or kind of capital asset holders are dealing with right now, is you probably have a solution, maybe you're using it for a different type of commodity or byproduct, and you haven't maybe tried pomace, or you want to try this moisture content type of pomace that exists. So during the RFI period, if you were to request a sample of that, you know, maybe you run that through your existing equipment that is in your own facility somewhere else across the country to really prove out that viability. And then when you come into your full app, you can say, hey, here's what it took to do it in an existing facility. We can keep doing it with us and it would cost maybe X, Y, and Z, or in the long run, it's more viable, you know, build something out there. So I would imagine that's probably some of the conversation and trial you're going to be doing during the RFI period leading up to the full application. So keep that in mind for those of you that are processors or manufacturers or just byproduct, you know, handlers.
Yep.
Awesome. Well, maybe before we wrap up here, Julian, Alex, any final pieces of advice for the interested applicants on the line and what you're looking for during this LOI period right now? I know we've talked a lot about it, but maybe just a single message to drive it home.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think in the letter of intent phase, there's a couple things I'd point out. You know, just being, you know, it providing a clear description of what it is specifically you're doing. There's a lot of different applications coming in, and you know, being concise and quick, because it is a short application, is helpful in letting us understand clearly what you're doing, why it's innovative, things like that. I'd also really encourage people to leverage the video component of the letter of intent phase. There is the application itself is quite short, but the video allows you to kind of put a face to it, right? And discuss whatever you really want about your solution and why it works. So these don't have to be fancy videos. This could be your iPhone or, you know, smartphones propped up against your computer screen and just you talking at it for a bit. But it allows you to put a lot of information into a small bucket, which is helpful for us because the application itself is quite short. So, you know, don't be afraid to leverage that, and don't be afraid of, you know, recording a video of yourself in, you know, your kitchen. That's totally fine. And those are kind of the two main ones on the LOI. And then I'll just reiterate the point around the economics. We do want to understand how your company's financials, you know, if you're a startup or a company, we want to understand what the market is and what your, how that looks in relation to your idea with for this challenge. But we do also want to understand a little bit around, you know, what the POM Wonderful or Wonderful Company relationship to your company looks like, how that those economics work out. And, you know, we understand that this is early stage in the LOI and the RFI might be critical to answering some of those questions. But, you know, even talking through the, you know, what that looks like, if you can't put a dollar figure to it, if you can put a dollar figure to it, all the better. But yeah, those are kind of the three things, the, you know, conciseness, the video, and kind of the economics around the partnership for the LOI, at least.
Yeah, and all I would add is just, I think what I've been trying to hint at this whole time, like get your foot in the door, get your ideas out there, take a look at the LOI, whether it's online, or you can submit a request to the info at that you'll see at the bottom of the screen there. And we can send you a PDF of all the questions if you want to just take a look at that offline and kind of work on your application offline. So, you know, we're here to answer any questions that you have. But yeah, definitely, if you've got an idea, get it out there. And yeah, I guess with that, maybe we'll wrap things up unless you have any other questions, Angel, on your end.
Nope, I'll hand it off to you, Alex.
Okay, perfect. Well, yeah, thank you all for being here. Really appreciate you taking the time. Thank you, Angel. Thank you, Lily, from our team. Most of all, thank you, Julian, and the rest of the wonderful company and POM Wonderful team for being so interested in working on this challenge. You know, before we cut out here, just a couple of things for those on the line. So we have been recording. We will put this recording out online, both on ReFed's website as well as on the landing page for the POM Payday. So keep an eye out for that if you want to revisit this or if you want to share that with your networks. Reminder, the deadline for the LOI submission is December 7th, but as always, get those applications in as soon as possible if you want to really start talking to the wonderful company about your very specific questions that relate to your specific solution. And then lastly, as I mentioned, you know, if you have any remaining questions, if we weren't able to get to your questions today, definitely shoot us a note at info@wonderfulinnovation.com, as you see on your screen, and we'll be sure to get back to you. So with that, Julian, anything else or any parting thoughts from you before we sign off?
Oh, that's, I think you said it great, Alex. You know, just get those LOIs in as soon as you can, get your foot in the door and hopefully get as much time as possible for the full application and RFI period. That's it for me.
Wonderful. Well, we're super excited. We love this opportunity coming out there for all of you food waste fighting solution providers. Best of luck to everyone. Thank you as always for the incredible amount of energy, effort, and attention you give to this really important issue of fighting food waste. Best of luck. Have a great rest of your day.